Come on, Peg. Hey, we got a long show. I'll tell you, I'll be honest with you, Please. I'm humbled by that applause. You know why? Because my car got more applause on the NBC tour today than that. Boy, you're in a good mood. Thanks for coming tonight. Yeah. How many of you came out the Ventura Freeway today? Did you see the new off-ramp out there?
Right.
The Bob Hope off-ramp. Not bad. Now, instead of a stop sign, there's a cue card guy holding a card. Says, I want to tell you, it's really great to stop right here. Well, let's see. How are you tonight? Hey, that's...
I'm very well.
Are those purple trousers?
Yes, they are.
All right.
But, I mean, I don't know what significance that
is. I don't...
It's
never
the
seen
tie
wear
counts.
Purple.
It's
what?
It's the tie that counts.
Counts for what?
Well...
Well, why do I get into these things? I have no way to get out.
This tie is made from elephant hairs.
They killed a whole elephant to make your tie? What was that old thing? I've never seen a... Remember that? A purple cow? Wasn't there something from childhood? I haven't seen a purple cow?
I never hoped to see one.
Yeah. But I can tell you anyhow, I'd rather see than be one. Is that it?
Right.
Thank you. Thank you. Now I'd like to do my dog Spot. Oh. It's been kind of a bad week. First the Ayatollah dies, and... And then I hear today that Cher has broken up with Rob Camoletti. Gee. You know, I was sorry to hear that. They've been through a lot together. His graduation, getting his driver's license. I mean, that's too bad. Speaking of the Ayatollah, how many of you saw the film of the funeral? Is that a... What a wild send-off Khomeini got. It's the only coffin I've seen equipped with seatbelts and a roll bar. I guess they have a new temporary leader in Iran. Do you know that?
Yeah.
Called Ali Khomeini.
Yeah.
Yeah. And he's promised to be a kinder, gentler lunatic. Actually, according to the papers, he said today he wants to reach out to the United States. He's not ready to exchange ambassadors yet, he said. He wants to start kind of slowly. He said, but Iran was ready to consider trying potato chips in a can. So it's trying to make the bridge there. Did you know when the Ayatollah died what he said about this country in his will? He got one parting shot in. He said, may God curse the United States of America.
Yeah.
That nice man, huh? Cool guy. Not even that, he didn't stop there. He left us his subscription to the Columbia Record and Tape Club. We've got to buy 49 more albums within 2 years at the full price. Mean man. And some more bad news. Shirley MacLaine told me the Ayatollah will come back next year as an Amway salesman at El Monte. By the way, Shirley MacLaine is going to be with us tomorrow to talk about, I don't understand. Maybe I will learn tomorrow from Shirley. Let's see what else is new. Rob Lowe's lawyers. Have you been following this kind of messy thing? His lawyers filed suit in Atlanta today against the parents of the young girl, apparently in his video, claiming they blackmailed him for $500,000. Actually, we found out they wanted $1 million, $500,000, and $2. Because when he returned the tape, he didn't rewind it. Okay, here's... Now, politically, it was in the papers today that Democrats, this is hard to believe, are trying to get, guess who, to run for the Senate from North Carolina. Andy Griffith.
Right.
I'm not making it up. They're trying to get Andy Griffith. And Andy turned him down, and I think it was a wise move because the Republicans probably would have linked him romantically with Barney Fife. Andy Griffith for Senate. Who's next? Bartles and James? What's going on? How many of you have Time magazine stock at all this past week? Nobody?
No.
Boy, you would have made a killing. The stock went up what?
44
points? Because apparently Paramount Studios offered to buy Time magazine for what? $10 billion. Now, there's a lot of speculation why they would pay that kind of money, and I have a theory. I think, first of all, they want to get that phone alarm clock. And I think the sports blooper video. And if you think about it, it's $1 billion off the regular newsstand price. Right. Now, is there anybody here from Boswash? Now, you think I'm... It's B-O-S-W-A-S-H. You know what that is? That's from the United States Census Bureau. They've come up with terms to define certain geographical areas in the United States. And Boswash is the stretch between Boston and Washington. Yeah. And they have one called Chipitz, and it's an area between Chicago and Pittsburgh. I'm not making all this up. Now, if you live exactly midway between Burbank, Gardena, Dublin, Cheeseboro, Smolensk, and Freiburg, Germany, you are in Burger Double Cheese Small Fries. Real construction job on that joke, wasn't it? Did you read that the Internal Revenue Service are after Jim and Tammy Baker? They'd like they're trying to get $1.2 million out of Jim and Tammy for back taxes. So Jim phoned Oral Roberts today and said, he said, Oral, can you help me out? We're both men of the cloth. And God says, and Oral says, let me call you back. I've got God on hold. If I'd have said that right, that'd have been dynamite, wouldn't it? Here was a little filler item in the paper today. This is stuff they put in when they don't have a big story. They call them filler items. Did you know that the first vacuum cleaner was invented 120 years ago today?
No.
Yeah. Now, if you remember, as with any great invention, there's always a trade-off. Remember when the automobile came out? It put blacksmiths out of business. So there's a trade-off. And even though the inventor of the vacuum cleaner made a great deal of money, it was pretty much the end of the career for the great Alphonse, the human dirt sucker. Okay. You possibly may be right. Now, this is kind of a freaky item, but it's true. There's a new product in England that may soon be available over here. It is a tombstone. And in the tombstone, they have a videotape player. I'm not making it up, that shows tape of the deceased person. Now, that's all we need, a cemetery with a whole bunch of VCRs flashing 12 o'clock. Okay, tonight, Alphonse, the human dirt sucker, didn't sound like that. Cybill Shepherd is here tonight.
Yes.
Yes. A tasty morsel. Very funny man, Martin Short. Is with us. And the Jeff Healey Band. Good stuff. Stay where you are. We'll be right back. Okay, tonight, Cybill Shepherd is here, Marty Short, Jeff Healey and his band, and our audience. Somebody asked, what about these cards? We'll explain this in a moment. Now, can't we get a better... Just look at this. This is a big, expensive show.
You think a nice teak tray or something we'd have?
Look at this. This is our prop box.
Isn't that awful?
How many of you are familiar Now, men won't admit this, because I have a feeling that women probably are the biggest fans of these books. These are the romance novel. How many of you read them? Be honest, man.
A lot.
I guess the most famous author of these is a lady by the name of Barbara Cartland.
Yeah.
Is that true? Does that name ring a bell? Who's written, I guess, hundreds of these. Yeah. But I guess they're in the, you find them in the supermarkets, and they, the titles are marvelous. Look at this one, and the covers. Look at this one. So Wild a Dream.
Oh.
And they're pretty steamy. I love this one. Lord Grey Falcon's Reward.
Yeah.
The Would-Be Widow.
Ah.
Catherine Kramer. I'm not familiar with these authors. I'm sure they're probably talented authors. Under Gypsy Skies. Here's one by Mary Mayer Holmes. Are you familiar with her? The White Raven. How many of you men read these? Now, be honest. How many women read them?
Women?
I think women.
Mostly women.
Now, believe it or not, have you ever thought of how many of you are frustrated authors, would like to write a book? All right. Here's a book that is available in the bookstores. It's called The Romance Writer's Phrase Book. And what it is, it contains 3,000 phrases that you can insert into your love novel. And they're hysterical. We've just typed out a few to give you an idea. They're full of them. I'll just open anywhere here. She could hardly lift her voice above a whisper. Her voice broke with huskiness. These are all certain things. Voices, they tell you how to do voices. Eyes, for example. You look under eyes, you want a description. His dark eyes flashed a gentle but firm warning. He looked at her as if he were photographing her with his eyes.
Whoa. You're getting us hot.
Yes. You're lonely, aren't you?
Yes.
The ferocity of his passion was frightening as well as exalting. His black eyes impaled her. And that's not all. It's not in here. She admired his driving intelligence. Now, here's one. Now, this is typical stuff. Manly wisps of dark hair curled against the V of his open shirt. Yeah, you see? Yeah. Now, somebody asked me during the break, what about these cards? Well, we have 500 people, so what we did, we asked you to write one sentence. A romance between these are our hero and heroine, Brett and Hillary. We ask the audience to give us one romantic sentence. It can be long or short, happy or sad, but it should describe a special moment between our dashing hero and his stunning sweetheart. They can be steamy, but not X-rated, because after all,
it's a family show.
We are on television. So we have collected these cards. We put them in some kind of order quickly. Let me give you some of the names of the authors. Tonight, first of all, a little production value here.
Oh.
That's right.
Yes.
You want to put a little cap on this and make it look like we've spent a few bucks. So it's time now for a feature we call You Are the Author.
Hey.
We will not necessarily be able to mention everybody's name, but some of the authors are Laurie Ward, Kelly Lewis, Jeanette Franks, Terry Matheson, Tim Hine. Are you all here?
Yeah.
Okie dokie. All right, enough suspense. Let's see what kind of a novel you put together. And to give us a little production value, it's what this needs. We've got an art card, costs us, what, $5-$10?
Yeah.
Ross Tompkins is over at a Celeste? Or an organ or what?
No, it happens to be an organ.
Fine, okay.
All right.
And Ross, could you give us just a little mood background? It's not an audition, just, underneath. It was a dark and stormy night. Brett's heart skipped a beat when he saw her. Then it skipped another three beats. He was in serious need of medical attention. Hillary was small and nice smelling. Like an Airwick solid. His eyes were as black as the bottom of a muddy stream, which Brett would get the boots of his heart stuck in. Brett knew this would be more than a few fleeting moments of shabby pleasure. It might be an entire evening of shabby pleasure. Hillary wanted to experience more than love. Hillary wanted to experience more than romance. Hillary wanted to experience something that had the word multiple in it. Brett, I love the caress of your hands and the gentleness of your lips. But Mom says that tonight has to be the last night. So let's do it one more time for the Gipper. He thought to himself that she moved much the way Hannibal would have moved if he'd crossed the Alps on snakes. Where is that weird person in the audience? Brett took a step. Hillary took a step. Brett took two steps. Oh, Brett, you big masculine hunk, energize me. Brett was a man of countless parts, but two or three would be enough for Hillary. Hillary, after many months liposuction treatment, was now able to hug Brett without fear of losing him. To other girls, Brett was a sex machine, but to Hillary, he was merely a small appliance. Folks, I can't help it. Brett's muscles rippled under his shirt, then his muscles rippled over his shirt. Steroids, she thought. Say, let's go back to my apartment for a drink, and I'll introduce you to my bed. Was she ever lovelier? Was she ever more radiant? God, I hope so, he thought to himself. Losing the mood here. Brett loved the way the sun played off her long blonde hair, cascading halfway down her back. Too bad, he thought, it doesn't start on her head. Now, that's an old joke. His entire body glistens with sweat, making a shoehorn unnecessary. Hillary wept at the tenderness of his love. Oh, darling, your lips tempt me to do wrong. Hillary silhouetted herself in the moonlight. The drapes blew slowly across her nakedness, and Brett thought to himself, hey, lucky drapes. Brett said to Hillary, should we make love or go to the Carson show? Hillary said, who are the guests? And then Brett, sweeping Hillary into his arms, said, I'll love you forever, but he bit his lip. Then he bit her lip. He liked biting her lip much better. Her ruby red lips glistened in the dim light of the sunset, but he kissed her anyway. As Brett and Hillary ended their long, passionate kiss, Hillary realized her gum was missing. Oh, Brett, I never thought I could feel this way again after the twins. I can't believe it. Brett unhooked the back of the bra, and it fell silently to the floor. Then Brett said, now you take off your bra, Hillary. Brett's love for Hillary found him having inner stirring. He hadn't felt since he fell down the stairs on his keys. But just as Brett was going to kiss Hillary goodnight, Hillary said seductively, do you want to get squishy? Squishy. Yes. And as Brett tenderly lit her cigarette, she said, but I wanted a Bud Light. Finally, he said, marry me this Saturday, 11 a.m. here in Burbank, and that's exactly what they did. So join us next time as Brett says to Hillary, oh, Hillary, your eyes are like sparkling emeralds. Your cheeks are like red roses in spring. Your breath is like, did I mention how nice your eyes look? Welcome, Hillary. You are the author. We'll try that again. Thank you. Oh, some wild things in there. What is it?
Sir.
Well, of course. Very good. We'll be back with our guests. All right. Now, my first guest. Martin Short is a very... Martin Short. Marty Short is a very inventive comedian and a very talented actor. And this month he has a comedy special called I, Martin Short, Goes Hollywood. It'll be seen on HBO. Would you welcome Martin Short?
What is with Ed tonight?
Hello, John.
You're doing David Steinberg right
it's
off, right?
It's so great to be here tonight, John. Especially with Ed and you and my old friend, Doc.
Good to see you again.
Good to see you.
What did I see? Was it the special? Did you do a special before this where you were singing?
Yes.
You sing? I did not realize that you sing. You were a singer, were you not?
I used to be.
I'm not putting you on. You sing well.
Well, thank you. I used to be a boy singer before I became a gal singer.
Yes, no.
But I know.
That's what they call them in the business.
No,
the boy,
I was
the boy
22.
Singer.
I used to do this show called, it was in Canada, called Everything Goes, hosted by Norm Crosby. I would sing.
Wayne and Schuster were on that show?
Yes, Wayne and Schuster. Nanette Pagliarello was on that.
Oh, yeah, I did a long time ago.
And I saw it.
Yeah, well, I got away from that. You know what? Real quickly, when I opened in Vegas the first time in 1963, I thought, I don't know why. I wanted to do something, I figured, not just comedy. So I'll do a little song. And I got Tony Mottola to work out a thing, and I was going to do Shadow of Your Smile, right? With a guitar, just us all, just guitar. As the relief from the excruciating laughter. Right. Did I feel, and I come out with a guitar, I look down, and there's Robert Goulet inside. The boy said, "But hell the night." It was all over. I cut it night, and it was the end of it.
But
I wouldn't do it.
When you're in comedy...
I have to do this. Okay. Freddie is panicking. Mr. Panic, we call him.
Hi, Fred.
We'll do this. We're coming right back. If I... These people be having fun.
Yes, we're having a good time. Is it John?
We better get into this bit. We've been running along here tonight. And tell us about you. You do a lot of characters. You do.
Called I, Martin Short, Goes Hollywood. Mm-hmm. And it's me kind of looking at my stay in the last year and a half here.
It's an irreverent look, I would guess.
I would say it's an irreverent look. It starts, you know, it starts at the theater where I used to go in Hamilton, Ontario, Canada. But it's that movie theater, the theater that inspired me to get into show business. But that theater's gone through changes. They're now showing Bang the Bum Slowly. You know, it's a different kind of theater. We look at a character, Dale O'Day, who inspired me. He's kind of a Jack Haley Sr. type, you know. Uh-huh. If I only had a heart, Dorothy. But he does this film. Then I play Irving Cohen, the legendary song writer, you know, who writes around 300 songs a day, all of them bad.
Right.
You know, in fact, if he were here today, John, this next, and the character, the clip we're going to show is a cosmetic surgeon. And he just, you know, expounds on the necessity for cosmetic surgery within Hollywood.
As they say, watch the monitor. We say that frequently here, but do.
I think in this town in particular, plastic surgery is a necessary tool. It could not only add 10 years to a star's career, which I think is super, but it can make you be who you want to be. Finally, so few people want. Now, Myrna here has been working for me for how long, dear? 6 years?
That's right, doctor.
And she has had work done. How old are you now, Myrna?
I'm 38, doctor.
Next year is the big Jack Benny birthday. But you look great. Let me just feel this. See, now that seems a little bit loose. Let me try that coin test of mine. Good Lord, that should have bounced a lot farther than that. Well, you're definitely due for another little nip. When are you slated?
A week Wednesday.
Luckily for Myrna, she works here, so she gets a rate. Although not much of one.
Bye, Doctor.
Michael, are you leaving?
Yes, I have to go screen Butterfield 8.
Very good, then. And I can't tell you how pleased I am with this new chin.
Oh, well, thank you.
Remember to call me next Wednesday and we'll discuss that whole forehead area. No reason it has to look that manly. Great kid.
Another, yes, another message, folks. And we'll be back. Cybill Shepherd's here. And Jeff Healy.
You did a little Tony Bennett in the commercial. Let's just hear that one.
No.
Mr. Sunshine.
No.
Well, these are
No. When you do it good, I'm not going to follow that and come in second. That's dumb. That's dumb. No.
Tony Martin.
My boulder. Tony Martin.
Well, then do Bogart.
No. With geometric, no, I don't get me into that. With geometric logic, but they fought me at every turn.
I proved with geometric
logic. I would have found the key.
I cannot do Humphrey Bogart.
Obviously.
No kidding, Marty.
You're halfway between Bogart and Edward G. Robinson.
Yeah.
Is that what you did? Did you start with it? Most comedians, for some reason, as kids, start mimicking other people.
Yeah.
It's kind of a... You don't have any material, so you use other people's voices and do their stuff.
Yeah, I think it is a compliment to the person that you're impersonating, ultimately. I mean, I used to do, Jerry Lewis as a kid. And then Jerry got older, and you got into that thing. Hi, how are you, Ed? Hey, nice tie, babe. And then, it's interesting to see them change. Betty Davis was someone who, in the old days, she would say, "What a lovely day it is today." And then as she got older, it was just the same voice, but just slower. "What a lovely day it is today." And a lot of,
Just slowed down.
I used to impersonate people and listen. I guess it's an obsessive personality that you have, impersonators have. They just have to keep, listening to the voice and listening
and
to
sounds. Did you make sounds in school?
Yeah.
To distract people?
Oh, yeah. Only when the teacher was weak. If the teacher was strong, then I wouldn't go near it. But, and then you finally meet these people, and you really are intimidated by that first meeting. As you know, I went to a theater, this is about 10 years ago, and I was by myself. And I was going to see the royal family, and I was very excited, and I'm sitting there, and the seat's empty beside me, and all of a sudden I see Katharine Hepburn is walking down. Now, I did Katharine Hepburn. I didn't really do it well then, but, I do it well now. But she's walking down. She's walking down, I hear this. "Excuse me, get the hell out of there. Why that hat? Excuse me, move that umbrella, thank you." And she, and she sits like... If you're going to do that with every nuance, I can't get through this story.
You dirty rat.
No, so Hepburn's sitting there, and I didn't say anything to her, So now I get into the play, and it's Royal Family, and Rosemary Harris is a star, and it was wonderful. And she does this, at the end of Act One, she does this dramatic diatribe, and she collapses in a heap of emotion. I was really moved, and I turned to Hepburn, forgetting it was Hepburn, and I said, "Isn't she classy?" And Hepburn, because I was talking to her like a normal person, said, "Oh, she's wonderful. She's very much like Spencer Rosemary in that she just listens to the other actor. Very few actors do that. I admire her tremendously. I do." So while she was talking to me, I was aware that I was now talking to Katharine Hepburn. So then I said to her, "Well, Miss Hepburn, you're no slouch."
Good.
And she looked at me and said, "Isn't that interesting?" So would you mind changing seats? Thank you.
We gotta leave. We're coming back. All righty, now moving along. Here's a marvelous lady, a fine actress. Would you welcome Miss Cybill Shepherd?
Get out of here. You are so great. I'm in love.
Time for our next guest now. I didn't read this whole introduction. I didn't realize this. You were a former Miss Memphis teenager, right? And then you went on to be, and it says here, you went on to become Miss Congeniality. At a Miss Memphis teenage?
Miss Teenage Memphis, yes.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. How do they judge Miss Congeniality? What does that mean? I mean, did the girls like you? The judges like you or what?
The girls like me.
Yeah.
But I was embarrassed to admit that for years.
Why?
Because I was trying to cultivate this aloof persona, but I'm not really like that at all.
Yeah.
So that's funny.
You think beauty... what do you think of beauty contests? You like, are you for them or against them?
Well,
a lot of the feminists think they're, you know... You didn't win.
Well, I didn't win that one. They're better if you win them.
Yeah.
I didn't even make it in the finals.
Yeah.
The girl that won did hula as her talent.
That's always the way it is. That's tough. Tough stuff. Did you win any luggage or anything like that? Or you win something. So moonlighting has come to an end.
Yes.
Yeah. What were your feelings of that? You were on for what, 5 years?
Well, 4 years, but really, calendar-wise, 5 years.
That's a pretty good run.
Oh, it was extraordinary. It was incredible. It was a break of a lifetime. And, yeah. You know, I got... It was an enormous opportunity I'll always be thankful for. But it was like getting out of prison, actually.
Well, what do you mean? Expand
on that. It's so wonderful. It's a great opportunity. It's fabulous. But the last day, I mean, I felt like, you know, in those movies where they show a scene where somebody's getting out of prison and you go in this room and they give you your watch back and they give you your
You get $5
back
in the suit,
and
yeah.
$5 and I got to be myself again, playing the same character for 5 years. And I almost killed myself the last day of shooting.
What do you mean?
Well, we were shooting in this church that has one of the four biggest organs in the world. And I was looking...
Yes?
I know that church.
Yes.
It's a real church, really, but I was looking up at a particularly large part of the organ.
Yes.
Great. And there was a step somewhat like this, and I fell. And I thought, this is great, I'm going to kill myself. I've survived 5 years of this, and now I'm going to kill myself the last day.
Now, the tabloids were full of all kinds of things between you and Bruce Willis. Like, mm-hmm. You hated each other, you were beating, shouting matches, name-calling, screaming, throwing stuff, all of that stuff.
Yeah.
Why don't you tell us what really went on?
Well, we did all that.
Did you really?
We really did.
You didn't get along?
No, actually, we underneath everything, there's a we both have a lot of... why are you smiling?
I'm smiling. I always smile at attractive ladies. underneath it all?
There's a lot of...
Was this like a Virginia Woolf relationship? Love-hate type of thing or what?
Well, no, there is a great respect and really love, I think.
Why underneath did you fight? What did you fight
all,
about?
Deep down underneath it. Underneath all of it.
Really down deep. I mean, did you argue about? Was it ego problems?
Well, it was like rats in a cage. I mean, like, you know, too many rats in too small a cage. You start eating each other after a while.
Yeah.
But...
Do you keep in touch? I mean...
Well, we haven't talked since we stopped shooting, but...
Really?
But we really do. We really... We did a little bit of everything. I mean,
if somebody calls you tomorrow and says, would you like to make a movie with Bruce Willis? Would
Absolutely.
You would? Okay.
I think he's a wonderful actor. I have a great respect for him. Yeah. And we just need a break from each other.
Yeah.
It was like being married to someone, you know, like a forced marriage kind of thing.
Yeah.
But if you have to be forced marriage, I mean, if you have to be, you know, forced to be married to someone, I guess that yeah. Bruce Willis would, you know, be right up there.
Yeah. You are a single lady now, or as they say?
Yes.
Yeah.
But, you know, I have to be honest that I don't know many men who could handle me 16 hours a day, you know.
Really? Why do you say that? What do you mean?
Well, after 16 hours...
Are you difficult to live with?
Yes, I think, you know, working 10 months straight, 16 hours a day, I mean, maybe you could handle it, but...
No. No, I don't know. That's tough.
Yeah.
Are you easy to be around? What bugs you? What really sends you off?
I think I'm...
You have any patience at all?
Yes, normally I do.
Mm-hmm.
But when you work, you know, 16 hours a day for 5 years, it just, there's a lot of stress, and it sometimes turns you into a kind of person that... Like, I threw a briefcase through a door once.
Where was this?
This was on the set of Moonlighting. It was near the end of the series, near the end of the year. It was, you know, 10 months, and
yeah.
It's just hard. I don't know. It's hard to do that. And I hate to complain because it's the greatest... Thank you. It's the greatest opportunity of a
yeah.
lifetime. But I think shortly after that, Bruce threw a chair through the doors and we had to replace them.
Yeah, sounds like a real nice relationship, yeah. Now you got to...
But we screamed at each other before the fights, you know? We realized at a certain point, like 2 years into this, that we always had a huge fight when we had to fight. And it was real, what you saw.
But by doing that, does that bring your performance up? Some people do that. You
well,
know,
I hope work, it did.
Yeah. Now you've got two new children?
Yes.
Twins,
20
right?
20 months old. Twins, yes. Oh, thank you. Yeah.
Somebody said you started pumping iron at a gym. What for?
Well, you know, lifting those babies, they're kind of hefty.
Yeah.
And, you know, so why not?
Yeah. Now, what's coming up for you now? Now that you're not working regularly, are you more bored than you were when you were doing the moonlighting?
You're going to worry my mother and father by saying that, not
why?
Working regularly, because they're always concerned. When's your next job? When's your next job?
Yeah.
Well, I should have a job any minute. No, no, I have a couple of jobs, but it's just trying to figure out whether I can do both of them or if I just have to do one because of time constraints.
Do you like more children? Like a big family?
More children. Well, let's just say I have my hands full. Having twins is like having a barrel of monkeys. I mean, it's twice the joy, it's twice the blessing, and it's wonderful, but it's like four times the work.
Yeah.
Now, people always say, oh, why didn't you bring the twins? And I say, I'm not sure you really want two-year-olds in your house. Tearing up, and they're ganging up on me at this stage.
Yeah.
They use each other. You know, here, get down on your knees so I can crawl up on you to reach this thing that Mother's put up there. biting and hair pulling has become a major thing. I was really worried about my daughter, my daughter for a while, because my son was constantly pulling her hair and biting her, and then one day she woke up, and now we don't have that problem as much.
Yeah.
She's biting and pulling back.
Do you get home? Do you get back to Memphis often?
Not often enough.
Yeah.
Yeah.
When you go back, do they treat you just like you were when you were there, or they say a Cybill Shepherd movie star?
Oh, no, I didn't even win Homecoming Queen. I mean, I'm just a normal person to them. Yeah. They kind of equal, great equalizer. But I did buy a condominium there, and they voted on the board to not let me have it. They didn't want me living in the same, yes, they voted. I bought it, and then the day before the furniture was supposed to go out to Memphis.
Because you're in the entertainment business?
Well,
they did that in New York. Some people tried to buy a co-op or something, and they were turned down, I guess, on the grounds that they were in the entertainment business.
Well, I don't know, because this one lady was quoted as saying, you know, well, when Elvis moved in over there on Audubon Street, you know, those people couldn't even get to their houses.
Oh, so they were afraid that you'd have...
They were afraid that that would happen, but then they changed their mind, because everybody... It was actually a great thing, because people became aware that, you know, that I was wanted to come back home, and the mayor called me, and...
That's nice.
And they asked me to come back there, and but I decided I needed to live somewhere else.
Okay. We'll take a break. We'll be right back. And we are back. Mm-hmm. What are you two talking about? How many is it? What are you two talking about?
Tell him.
Go ahead. Tell him.
I asked her.
Were you hitting on her or what?
No. Well, in a way, I was asking her if she was still breastfeeding. But because she had been talking about first of all, I said, do you have other children? She said she had a 10-year-old. And then I said,
Clementine, yes.
And then
yes.
I said, boy, twins, I heard that there's a lot of work. And I said, did you breastfeed? And she said, I still am.
Yes, I think you did, didn't you?
Yes, I did.
Isn't 20 months a little old for that? I mean, I don't remember, but...
It's a little heroic on my part, I guess.
Yeah, but they say that's very good for the young people. And good for the woman, right?
I've enjoyed it. It's a little strange now because they tend to want... Whatever breast they're on, they want the other one.
So true.
I keep telling...
That's so true.
I keep telling them they're both the same.
Yes, well, good. My apologies to Jeff Healey and the band. We ran a little long tonight. I'm humbled by that applause.